Welcome back once again to Discussion-Based Teaching Explained, a channel dedicated to discussion-based classrooms on which I will explore how to teach and learn in a discussion-based environment. I'm Adam. I'm a teacher, and I've been developing a discussion-based teaching practice now for 18 years. And though it's very much still a work in progress, on this channel, I hope to explore some beliefs and practices that I've found successful over the years. So let's do a quick review of where we've been so far, okay? The first 7 episodes of Discussion-Based Teaching Explained focused on discussion-based teaching philosophy. Then in episodes 8 through 18, we looked at discussion skill-building practices, how to spend that first third of class for at least the first third of the year. And there's a lot of skills we reviewed. In the last few episodes, I've turned my attention towards journaling in your discussion-based classroom. Remember, discussing and journaling are symbiotic. In episode 21, I explored 7 motives for using journals. In episode 22, I explored salient points, a great journaling exercise. In episode 23, I offered 5 additional basic but beastly journaling exercises. And in episode 24, I looked at 2 special journaling events, hyperlinking and dialectical notebooks. This will be the last episode about writing in discussion-based classroom. In this episode, I'm going to discuss the importance and practice of metacognition. But before I do, I really need to give a shout out, even more than a shout out, to the Bard Institute of Writing and Thinking. I've done a lot of professional growth in my 18 years, but nothing comes close to Bard's Institute of Writing and Thinking for changing my teaching practice, for changing my understanding of how writing, thinking, and discussing go together. Episodes 21 through 25 of DBTE are like taking your little pinky and dipping it in the Bard cake frosting and tasting it. But you really want to go to Bard's Institute of Writing and Thinking and like get a cake in the face. Okay, so on to metacognition. Metacognition is the understanding and awareness of one's own thought processes. Simply put, for me, this means helping students think about their own thinking. And as with everything on DBTE, the students need to be trained how to do this, not just kind of hoping, we're not just hoping they do. So basically, you've got to make some time for metacognition. Here are 5 things to remember about metacognition. Number 1, it goes beyond reflection. I mean, metacognition is certainly related to reflection, but I kind of see it as reflection is a process where you comment on what happened, and metacognition is a process where you comment on what happened for you or in you during the process of what happened. Like, reflection can be done by the sideline reporter, but metacognition is kind of something that the player does after the game, or hopefully during the game. Number 2, metacognition is written, I think. In fact, the reason metacognitive processes are in this series of writings is because I think basically they're much more effective if they're done in writing. Now, the writing doesn't need to be long, but there's a different quality to a student talking about or kind of riffing metacognitively as opposed to sitting quietly and thinking about and writing metacognitively. And number 3, as I said, it can be quick. It doesn't need to take much time, and it's really, really powerful for students. I usually strive to have like a 2 to 5 minute process writing metacognition every week. Let me share with you some prompts I've used. So usually maybe in the last couple minutes of class, towards the end of the week, I'll ask something like this. What happened as you talked or read? Tell the story of your reading of this piece. Where were you pushed in? Where were you pulled out? What do you mourn which did not end up on the page or in the discussion? How do you learn best? Tell about a teacher who still lingers with you. What happened to you? Is there anything you want to hold on to? How is it reading your work? Reflect on what you just did. Process write about looking at whatever. I would also say metacognition's kind of got to be frequent, or at least consistent. I mean, it's fair to say that each individual 2 to 5 minute process writing session isn't doing a ton on its own, but together as a habituated regular practice, it's very impactful. This kind of builds skills in our students to practice metacognition without us there to lead them through it. And that's what we want, right? We want them being metacognitive just normally and next year and in college and in their careers. We want them to be students of their own thinking. And the 5th thing about metacognition for me about processing is that it happens individually and it happens for the team. So I do think it's super important for individual discussants to practice metacognitive process writing. And I also think it's key for the team to do so as well. How is the team working or not working? What are you seeing? With this in mind, I will hand out a rock about every 4 to 6 weeks. I got to tell you, as you probably figured out, I really love acronyms, and ROC, R-O-C, stands for Review of Class. Usually at the end of a class period, towards the end of the week, I'll give the students about 10 minutes to fill out the ROC. Check it out. Review of Class, Directions. This sheet will allow me to get some feedback on how the class is going for you. It is meant as a way for you to give me honest, accurate feedback, both positive and negative. This form is anonymous. Please do not write your name on it. You will have about 10 minutes to complete this ROC. I am particularly interested in your feedback on discussions. Please refer back to the notes you took during the week. Write your answers below the prompts. Number one, at what moment during recent classes were you most engaged as a learner? Be specific if you can, not just a day, but a moment in an activity. Why? Number two, at what moment during recent classes were you most distanced as a learner? Why? Be specific. Number three, what comment or action that anyone in the room made or took during recent class did you find most affirming or helpful? Be specific. Who exactly? What did they say or do exactly? Number four, what comment or action that anyone in the room made or took during recent classes did you find most puzzling, confusing, or unhelpful? You don't need to use a name if you don't want to. Number five, what surprised you most about class recently? Six, who do you think was class most valuable teammate, MVT, recently? Seven, what did they do, qualities they exhibit, actions they take, ways they talk, attitudes they display, etc., to merit the MVT? So you read through the ROCs from each period. You're looking for trends and isolated, like, stellar comments. And then you go into the class the next morning and you say some of the things you found. And you can even use the anonymous student quotations to add credibility and kind of like some student-centered language to the feedback you're giving the team. I even like that MVT concept at the bottom because it helps me compare what I'm seeing in the class to what some of the students are seeing. And it really is good material for me to share with students if they receive some feedback from their peers about being the MVT. So the ROC gives you really valuable feedback, and it allows the team to like think about the team metacognitively, which is a really valuable thing and can really help a team grow. So there you go, two ways to deploy powerful metacognitive process writing. In the next few episodes of DBTE, I'm going to look at some like troubleshooting issues, like how do we grade discussions? How do we deal with students who overtalk? How do we deal with students who don't talk at all? How do we deal with large class sizes? So once again, thanks for tuning into Discussion-Based Teaching Explained. I'm Adam. If you have any comments, leave them below or email me at discussionbasedteaching@gmail.com. Thanks for watching.